Well, folks, it's our second edition of Locked Down Discs, and a familiar face appearing on screen, as he did last night, another familiar face. And in fact, there's, I suppose, there's a bit of similarity between Terry Payne and Pommie Mbangwa, as you see him, because both were pretty useful sportsmen in their own right, but perhaps they've become even more famous by their TV work. And they've probably spent, Pommie can confirm this, certainly in the case of Terry, I think he spent more time on television than he did on a football pitch. So, Pommie Mbangwa, great to have you on board, my old Super Saturday colleague and continuous Super Sport colleague. It's welcome to Locked Down Discs.
Hey, Neil, nice to be here. It's good that you're kind of figuring out what to do. I hope these discs are popular. I hope they're keeping you busy.
Well, you know what's fascinating? You're only the second, of course, of my guests. But I suspect that two things are going to happen. The diversity of people's musical tastes is obviously going to come through. But similarly, I think there's going to be some, probably over a period of time, some strange synergy as well, because good songs are good songs and good artists are good artists. So yeah, it'll be interesting. But from music point of view, always been close to music, have you enjoyed music?
Yeah, I have. So the story that I think of when people ask me about music and the knowledge of it, I don't really have a knowledge. I remember growing up being little, and I had a cousin, an older cousin, who used to listen to various things. So I'm trying to think how old I was and how old she was. She is at least 10 years older than I am. Mm-hmm. And so her taste was particularly different. So she'd have been a teenager, and I was this little guy listening to her, you know, listening to Temptations, yeah, from Temptations all the way to sort of Brenda Fassie, to such varied tastes of what, to country music as well. She used to listen to Dolly Parton and stuff like that. And so what it did was it made me appreciate pretty much all sorts. It doesn't matter what it is in terms of genre. There are rock songs that I like, or rock bands that I sort of say, well, there is a song by, I don't know, take an example, Pink Floyd, for instance, that I like. And you'd go all the way kind of backwards, forwards, whichever you want, to soul, some soul stuff like Temptations or whoever, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, you know, or gospel stuff, because I'm Christian and I love to listen to that sort of music. So, yeah, reggae, whatever you like, it's all in there.
It's interesting. I'm similar in many respects, because I grew up, I had a library card in Durbanville in Cape Town, and the library card, I was never interested in books. I still can't read. So I used my library card to take out albums. So it was dictated with all of this country, sort of soft country stuff, Crosby, Stills, Nash, Dan, John Focoli. But then, like you, I met somebody at Varsity, a friend of mine, who was into Pink Floyd, and he played The Wall all the time, and suddenly that opened my horizons, and good songs grew on you. We're going to start with Pommie's first song in a moment, but beforehand, for those that maybe are tuning in and missed our first Locked Down Discs with Terry Payne last night. So the principle is, it's loosely based on Desert Island Discs, which of course has run in the BBC since 1940. And the concept being that you are cast away on a desert island and you are allowed to take a number of songs with you, and only a number of songs. So we of course are not suffering on a desert island. We are locked down, and hopefully you are looking after yourself and taking care and staying strong. So Pommie has the decision to make of five songs, although he's been pleading with me all day. He says he's down to seven and he can't narrow it down any further. So we might have to have a first slight variation, and then two movies, and if necessary, a book. But if I give Pommie seven songs, he's not going to be able to take a book. He can't have everything. So so if you're happy with that, we'll do that. But one of the first ones, so let's have a look. And I must say that, as the listeners and viewers will find out, that you have got a wide range of interests. One of the first guys that you mentioned to me was Smokey Robinson. Great sound, great voice. You want to take a song of his with you?
Yeah. Oh, 100%. Maybe this is influenced by what's happening now. The fact that we're locked down means I can't go cruising with Sharon anywhere, you know.
You can, but they could be locked down for longer.
Oh, yeah. We'd both be locked down. Yeah, we'd be locked down for sure. So, yeah, that's been a favorite from the time I was in a teenager, really. Wow. Nearly in high school, and wow, it's just one of those tunes that gripped me. It was redone by a guy called D'Angelo, and he did it pretty much the same way. It didn't take too much out of it. In fact, he might have added a little bit. And his genre is what you'd probably call neo soul. But it doesn't really change the song at all. And so many times people are introduced to songs by the cover version rather than by the original. And with regard to Cruisin' by Smokey Robinson, I heard the original before I heard the next one. And I like both. I still do. I still think they're fabulous songs. And it's... tugs at my heart.
It's kind of that, you know, Motown sound, wasn't it? The Motown sound.
It is, yeah.
I've got it here, so we're going to play a little bit of it. This is Smokey Robinson and Cruisin', Pommie's first. First song from Pommie Mbangwa. What a voice.
Oh, awesome. They told the story as well back then.
You got it forever.
Yeah, okay. Well, sorry, I stopped it a bit quicker than I was meant to there, which is, but never mind. Don't worry about that in a moment. But yeah, so he's one of those guys that he's got just a distinctive voice. Terry was coming with Frank Sinatra and Nat King Cole again. You hear that voice and you know straight away that's Smokey Robinson.
Yeah, amazing artist. To be honest, I don't know a whole lot about it. You know, with all these shows, who is it, Simon Cowell, who has these, what are they called? America's Got Talent or Britain's Got Talent and what is it, Idols here in South Africa. You get all those shows, don't you?
Yeah.
And he's been on some, I'm not sure which ones, and he's a fantastic artist. He's a successful musician in his own right. But it's that one song for me. And I don't know, as I said to you before, and I'm not a musical guru, but there are things in music that I appreciate. I tend to like the sound of pianos for some reason. I absolutely love the sound of them. I didn't learn to play the piano. I did a little bit of music when I was in school when I was little. And it's something that I regret now that I didn't continue with and I haven't taken up. Somewhere along the line, maybe in the lockdown, one could have, you know, started again on the piano or on a guitar or something like that. But yeah, it's something I dearly love.
I hear what you're saying, because another one of our colleagues, Ed Jordan, I still marvel. I remember when we did that Super Saturday album and I had a couple of lyrics that I'd written and I said to him, I've come up with this lyric. And he said, give me the lyric. And then he sat down at a piano and said, must it sound something like this? And from nothing, just to create a melody, I don't know. Maybe you've either got it or you haven't. And I know I don't have it. I've got a good ear, but
I suppose it's kind of like that. I mean, my kids play the piano, learning to, I should say, actually. And both of them absolutely love it. The older one, 13-year-old, he not necessarily on the piano, but on... you know, these apps that you have on your iPad or, you know, whatever your Android device that you can make music with. He tries to do things like that, you know, gets creative and tries to put some lyrics to something with some sort of sound, you know, mix this, mix that. It's brilliant. Music is, it's soothing, isn't it? Yeah, for different occasions, isn't it?
Absolutely. Well, I inadvertently started your second song, so I might as well start that, and then we'll come back to it, and you can tell us what it is. People recognize it straight away. They'll recognize the reggae in it, and here it is. It's Bob Marley, of course. Another man who you're not going to mistake either the voice or the sound. Here is Bob Marley, and it's Pommie's second song, and he'll be jamming in lockdown.
Jamming, jamming. I hope you like jamming too. Ain't no how we can do it anyhow. I and I will see you through. The levels I provide.
Yeah, brilliant. I mean, he's a guy, I suspect that his name's going to come up many, many occasions during lockdown disc, because whether it be Redemption Song or whether it be No Woman, No Cry, just a great genre, great, and lost too early, of course.
Yeah, gone too soon. Gone way too soon. An artist, I think, who cuts across absolutely every spectrum of society, of our world. It doesn't matter. I mean, a guy used to sell out concerts absolutely everywhere. And you could put in a Bob Marley LP, CD, track, you know, album, whatever you want to call it, at absolutely any occasion. You know, it's one for all seasons. You know, you can just play. If you take, I don't know, let's pick an album, the Legend album, okay, and just play it. Like you said, you know, No Woman, No Cry, Buffalo Soldier, Shot the Sheriff, Jamming, whatever. All those songs will play, and everybody at the gathering will be quite happy with them. They don't rub anybody up the wrong way. And yet. So political in message, you know.
I was going to say that. I mean,
there's a lot. Incredible how that works.
A lot of people grew up, certainly white folk grew up jamming, excuse the pun, to Bob Marley. So I'm completely oblivious of what he was singing, whether it be Buffalo Song, and certainly Redemption Song and songs like this. But I suppose that's part of growing up and maturing, and then you delve a little bit into lyrics, and you find a little bit of the history, which. For me, makes him all the more appealing because, as you say, he hit across the board. So, great choice.
Yes. Went to Jamaica on cricket tour. And so, went to the Bob Marley house. You know, now it's an attraction. People go there and they kind of have a look at where the guy used to stay. And, yeah, I'm trying to think how old I was at the time. Probably 20 years old, maybe, about that. Maybe a bit more, yeah, maybe 24, around there, yeah, 23, 24. And kind of left an impression, impressionable already at the time, but it, you know, already liked him, already liked his music. There's already some sort of affinity because of him turning up in Zimbabwe in 1980, with Zimbabwe's independence. And so actually being at the guy's house, you know, and seeing these pictures and all the rest was a bit surreal. And it meant from then till whenever, I'm gonna like this guy's music. And you know, you listen, sometimes you just listen to the beats and you go with what, you know, what's happening, bob your head. But as time goes along, the words seep in, don't they? And you start to listen to what the guy is singing about and what he was saying, what he was trying to get across at the time. Very much ahead of his time.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got those two songs. I'm going to ask you to go for a movie because you've actually got three movies, and I don't want you to cut down the movies because all three are great movies. And one, I think the first one is not necessarily the order in which Pommie gave them to me, but this movie is going to come up plenty of times, and I want Pommie's take on it and why he took it, because he won't be alone in it. I suspect that if I had to take a movie or two to my lockdown, this would probably be on my shortlist, and it's Shawshank Redemption, a real deep, great story. But why are you taking it, Pommie?
Yeah, so It's a movie that's, I mean, they're parallels, aren't they, in the movie. You know, if you, Morgan Freeman's a guy I really like. Tony Robbins, I didn't really know anything about at the time of watching the movie. You know, he wasn't necessarily a big actor, not according to me and not to what I'd been exposed to. And it's just one of those movies that gripped me for friendship, right? And it's just an incredible bond that these guys end up having from a place of, you know, particular trial. I mean, so difficult is it? I wouldn't know about being in prison, but I can, I can imagine it's not pleasant, you know, even just from the pictures and from the way that the movie goes. And these guys form this bond, and it goes on to after they're, you know, well, one is released and the other one escapes. And that's it, really. It's just a reminder to me that friendship can be so special. I don't know how many times I've watched it. I've watched it over and over and over again. And it doesn't get, it doesn't get old. And I don't think it ever will. I think, you know, if you tell some young guy, oh, you want to check out a movie? Watch this, you know?
Yeah.
And they go and watch it, they'll love it. Today, whenever.
You'll probably resonate with what, and many viewers will likewise do the same with older kids. My kids grew up, and they don't, in my opinion, they don't make some good movies these days, but by and large, they're very, very few and far between. So I spent a lot of time with Gregory, who's now 19, saying, why are you watching that? And he said, oh, what are you? And so over a period of time, I said to him, why don't you just watch this? So I went through Shawshank Redemption, Forrest Gump, movies like this. And every time he'd say to me, why didn't you tell me about this before? This is the greatest movie ever. And Shawshank, Green Mile was another one.
Similar sort of movie.
You're
right.
Because with friendship, you think about that scene on top of the roof, of course, where they're all sharing beers. It's a great movie. The guy that sticks with me in that movie, it's very sad as well at times, is Brooks. Do you remember Brooks, who had the
the old guy, the librarian.
Yeah, librarian. He got released and lasted a week and took his
life. And then hanged himself. And Freeman has a great soliloquy in that, you know, explaining that they say you go in for life, and that's what it does. It takes the life from you, you know. And the guy
I'm getting goosebumps actually, just thinking of.
Exactly. When he went in, Brooks, of course, probably pretty similar to Morgan Freeman himself. But when he went in, he was a young man, right?
Yeah.
And there were no cars, and you know, and so when he got out, and this whole world had changed, you know, you imagine a guy in prison for 25, 30, 35 years, 40 years, whatever it is. And you come out and you're an old man, and there are cars. There weren't cars when you went in. There's electricity and stuff. The things have just changed, you know. And how do you assimilate sort of back into society is difficult. It's very difficult. Yeah, a lot of lessons.
Yeah, and we're moaning about 5 weeks of lockdown. Can you imagine? Here's your third song, going back to the songs. And this shows the mix of artists and sounds, although this is another great song. So this will be on many people's bucket list. And it goes like this. It is U2 and One. Great lyric. I'll let it play for a little bit. Pommie's third choice.
Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same? Will it make it easier?
You got someone to play.
One life.
Another great sound, and very soulful band. I mean, an Irish band, obviously, great lyrics. And if you think of some of their songs, With or Without You, that whole Joshua Tree album, you could probably take one. That's a great choice.
I tell you, I'm trying to think when I first heard it. But I remember first hearing it and thinking, I think that's Bono, but I don't know, you know? And U2 wasn't really a band that I listened to. Again, the kind of variance in the taste of music is because of who you're exposed to in, you know, in terms of the environments that you are. And in Zim, I went to boarding school, you know, and so there'd be kind of mix of people with regard to race, and so the things that they listened to and the music they listened to would be, you know, vastly different. And whilst in school, that's when I heard U2 and searched for the song. Like, older guys had it. I couldn't just go and say, please, can I listen to your music, your tapes or whatever it was, your LPs at the time. Because these guys were older, you know, and I would have to kind of sneak and listen whenever I could. And being a junior and them allowed radios and, you know, whatever in their studies, that's kind of how I got to like it. Didn't know the title to the song, didn't know really what it was about until much later after hearing it the first time. And since then, as you say, the biggest thing, it's so soulful. And wow, message is crazy. Message, absolutely crazy as a message. Such a deep song. That's it. Also, redone, there's an artist I like, Mary J. Blige, who did it. But funnily enough, I think that she spoiled it. They sung it together. They did a duet, Mary J. Blige. And
I was going to download that. That's quite interesting. I had the choices, and I thought, yeah, I'll go for the original, because the original.
Heard Mary J. Blige, and I thought, no, wrong person. I used to think, oh, it's okay. I like the song. And because I like the song, you end up kind of living with it. And then when you play one after the other, you're going, right, that's in the bin. That's just messing that up totally. And it's one of those songs I think nobody should do again. You know, it stands on its own. It's good as it is. It's a fantastic song.
Yeah, no, indeed it is. And I think you're right. Don't tamper with that. Okay, we're going to go back to the movies now. You've got a dead heat for second, or the other movies to take. The Usual Suspects, great movie. You can tell us and remind us of the stories. I'm not so sure that the lead actors, he's a bit persona on Grant at the moment.
I thought about that, you know. I don't know if I can
go with it. Be allowed to take
such
it.
A great movie. Yeah, exactly.
The Usual Suspects. And then a movie that I have watched, and I looked in my collection because I thought I had it, and actually it's the first movie that, of the two nights that people are talking about that I don't have, but I remember seeing it called Time to Kill, which loosely from my head was based in the American South, and was it Matthew McConaughey? Was he in that?
Yeah, a green Matthew McConaughey. He was just starting out. Sandra Bullock was in that as well, and Samuel L. Jackson. So he's Carl Lee Haney, right? That's his name. He's the guy whose daughter gets abused and brutally raped by these. The story is terrible. It's a southern Mississippi sort of film, and in that time, I mean, you can go think Jim Crow laws, all of those things, right? Ku Klux Klan, all of that, and that's what it's about. And then again, I think there's a sort of common theme with the movies that I end up liking, is there's a development of some sort of relationship between McConaughey, who's a young lawyer, and a white guy, with Samuel L. Jackson, who's a black guy. And in the South at that time, you know, they cared nothing for black people and Ku Klux Klan stuff and so forth. So when this guy's daughter is abused and it goes through this terrible tragedy, and this guy takes the matter into his own hands, Samuel L. Jackson, then he needs a lawyer. And just the to and fro is brilliant. Like, there's the scene where they're in the cell where he's been arrested, of course, because he shot this guy, or the two guys, and he shoots the policeman by mistake. But he's trying to explain to McConaughey, you know, how this is going to work, and he's trying to tell him, make him feel what he feels, you know, and he's saying, right, close your eyes, tell you this, what about this, imagine this little girl, imagine that, imagine, and then he says, now imagine she's white. I remember, it sticks with me, right, and that's a film that gives me chills, because I haven't watched it many times, because I'm afraid to watch it, because the story is so intense, and it's just, I don't know how humans, you know, how we can do this sort of thing to each other. That's the hard part about it. But I thought it was a fabulous movie.
It's a bit like Terry's movies last night, one of which was Casablanca, and the other one was One Flew Over Cuckoo's Nest. And you speak this nest, song, yeah. About, I'm going to have to go and watch both of those and Now a Time to Kill.
yeah.
I'm going to go back to them, because we've got to step it up, because we're running a little bit out of time, and I want to get back to your lockdown disc. So now here, I'm going to need a little bit of help, because this is something new for me. So that's part of the opening up. A guy, and you mentioned him early on, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes.
You're sort of going back to Motown time, you know. So you'll hear piano here, and that's what I like. It's fabulous music. This song was redone not too long ago by John Legend. John Legend does a duet with somebody. Yeah, so if you look it up, John Legend, I'm not sure who it is with, but he redoes this. And he, you know how he is, very musical, and also plays a piano quite nicely. So, yeah, a fabulous song. And the message, if you listen to it, wake up everybody, you know, it's brilliant. It's brilliant.
Well, here
song.
It is.
Love it.
Let's listen to it. This is the original, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. And there's the piano Pommie was talking about.
Brilliant tune.
Thinking ahead, so very much on where we need to be. War and poverty. Oh.
Wake up, everybody. It's amazing how good songs, good lyrics stand the test of time.
It's incredible.
All your songs tonight, and I have to say, with Terry's songs last night as well, they don't date really. Great songs just don't date, and that's one of them for sure.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think what kind of how old that would be, and my thinking is sort of 70s, maybe.
I think
maybe a bit.
When I looked at it, I think it was 75. I think I saw 75.
Yeah, so. Yeah, so if you think about what he's singing about, you could release that song today. You know, wake up everybody, time for thinking ahead. No more backward thinking, time for thinking ahead, you know? He also sort of says, you know, look after all the old people, because it's them who have it bad, you know, have it worse than everybody else. And it's not too long before, you know, they're gone, and you know, I think he says it's them who catch all the hell, you know, and it's not long before. The song is timeless, and it is, and it's a call to kind of humanity, and it's a call to everybody to kind of work together. And probably, if you think 75 and think America, yeah, it's still, America is still difficult today in terms of race relations and all of that. So it might well have been particularly political, but yeah, it's a great tune. I love it. The boys also, my kids, yeah, the two boys, they love it as well.
I downloaded it straight away, and I could get a vibe straight away and understand why you chose it, because it instantly hit a note. Speaking of which, here's a great Stevie Wonder is Pommie's voice, and a song that is Superstition. Stevie Wonder, obviously, you could have picked a number of different songs from Stevie Wonder. Here is Superstition, and it's Pommie's effectively last choice. So let's listen. Stevie Wonder, Superstition.
Down the world.
Stevie Wonder again. I mean, the one thing that I've noticed, similarly, I don't know whether there's going to be a trend right the way through all my guests, but selections are very much distinctive. So they are unmistakable voices there. Bob Marley, Steve Wonder. When you hear them, you know straight away, even Bono, there's no mistaking that sound. And Stevie Wonder,
yeah, and
one of his greats.
Yeah, and I guess, I mean, that's kind of how it goes. It's very difficult. You know, when you said, oh, you've got to pick five songs. As wide as my range is in terms of what I like, it's almost impossible. If you said pick 10 songs, I'd still find it difficult, because I think there's so many good songs, and there's so many songs and so many artists who I think would be distinctive. And then the choice obviously becomes subjective, you know. And with the subjectivity, there's, I keep saying this, that it depends kind of on the environments that you've been exposed to and what might have happened at that time when you heard whichever song and why it has stuck with you. There are songs you hear these days, and this is not to say there's no good music anymore, but there's songs you hear these days and you think, well, it kind of sounds like bubblegum, you know, like it just bang, 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 bang. It doesn't really sound like, you know, you'd be singing this song 20 years from now. Whereas these ones are all old, and they've all lasted, and they will stand the test of time. I won't be the last one to like them. And my kids, as I say, like some of the songs that I like as well, because then, you know, they're timeless.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Pommie, we've come to the end of our enforced lockdown time with each other. Anyway, there's a little bit still to go. Lockdown is concerned, but thank you very much. Thanks for your time, and thanks for I'm fascinated by your selection, because it's a wide range, although there is some, you can see that they belong in a cluster, so I don't think you're going to be alone in lockdown with those vibes, all those movies.
But no,
from you, maybe for the folks who are still watching there, obviously we're going through difficult times now. We can't wait for all the sport to restart and everything else, but I'm sure you'll agree with me that the bottom line is to stay safe, stay at home, and care for yourself. In fact, before we even went into lockdown, Pommie and I had this discussion over a cup of coffee, actually. So, and we were saying even then, even if we stay healthy, our own community stay healthy, for everybody else, you don't want to pass the virus on, because there might be somebody less fortunate out there.
Yeah, and I mean, what's it been? It's been 3 weeks now. We've been locked in, locked down, as it were. Some of us are more fortunate than others. I think it's a time where we have to kind of think that way. And there are many different initiatives with regard to helping where others are less fortunate and where others need help. The medical workers, all of those who are looking after those who get ill, need all of our help, all of us who are healthy. So I think it's a time to think in that way and think help where you can help. And I think it will be a good thing. Humanity needs to work together.
Pommie, we do indeed. And thank you very much for your time. It's been great fun. You've got a lot of vibes, good movies. Doesn't surprise me. Take care, my friend. We'll see you back on air sooner rather than later. Love to the family.
Yeah, thanks. And same to you across that side. Take care of yourself. And I hope all these lockdown, what are they called, discs go really well. I'm looking forward to watching them, actually.
Thanks, Pommie. Thanks. Cheers, man.